The Chinese Orthodox definition of spirit is the soul of a departed. According to Nevius, the Chinese believe that some of the best of the departed souls are raised to the rank of gods. These include officials who conducted themselves well and obtained a good name and favor with the emperor in life. In death, they are deified, and the emperor erects temples in their honor and memory, and their images are placed in the temple so that the people may worship them and copy their noble examples. In the process of time, these become guardian angels for the people, and lastly, they are gods. The spirits which are not fortunate as to be deified become demons. These possess people and are able to use their bodies to afflict people with diseases. When any such demons are asked when their home is, they answer that it is in the mountains or in the desert or in some cave. Sometimes they say they are traveling or are only there to pay a visit to a brother or a sister, to a father or mother, or that after a short time they will go away. Japanese and African beliefs. During the Edo period in Japan, that is between 1603 and 1863, the belief was that if a man died of disease or in an epidemic, he turned into a monstrous demon. This Japanese belief happens to be the belief in most African primate cultures as well. It is believed in Ghana, for instance, that if people die tragically and prematurely, their spirits become restless and haunt the living, Atofo or Saman Chen Chen. Alexander Campbell. Alexander Campbell was the 18th to 19th century reformer born in Scotland but emigrated to the USA. He was one of the founders of the Christian Church, that is the Disciples of Christ. He was a serious Bible student, a person who held the scriptures in the highest regard. Below is part of his conclusion in his address to the Popular Lecture Club, Nashville, Tennessee, on demonology on March 10, 1841. And I quote, "In one sentence, then, we conclude that there is neither reason nor fact. There is no canon of criticism nor law of interpretation. There is nothing in human experience or observation. There is nothing in all antiquity, sacred or profane, that in our judgment weighs against the evidence already adduced in support of the supposition that the demons of pagans, Jews, and Christians were the ghosts of dead men, and as such have taken possession of men's living bodies and have moved, influenced, and impelled them to certain courses of action." Quote ended. Campbell thought that some of the Jewish historians of the first century, such as Josephus and Philo, and some of the early church fathers believed the demons were the ghosts of wicked dead men. Referring to the position of Josephus and Philo concerning the identity of demons, Campbell wrote, and I quote, "The Jewish historians Josephus and Philo also avow this conviction. Josephus says demons are the spirits of the wicked dead who enter into living men and destroy them unless they are so happy as to meet the speedy relief. Philo says the souls of dead men are called demons." According to Campbell, Lardner, after examining most of the works of the fathers of the first two centuries, came to the conclusion that the universally prevalent theory among them was that demons were the souls of dead men. Kidon Kim. Dr. Kidon Kim is a senior pastor of the 21st Century Songrak Church in Seoul, in South Korea. He believes demons are not for all, but that the soul he proceeds has been being a matter of control for a long time. Some souls who fell last to the earth, the devil. Others say demons. Generally saying that angels belonging to about the identity of Jesus. I have already made my point concerning the question, saying that a demon is an unbeliever spirit after death. Are demons fallen angels or the souls of dead men? A summary of the various opinions put forward by scholars and deliverance practitioners is illustrated here. So when we look at a summary of what I have gone through of the opinions of scholars and deliverance practitioners, the Evangelical Dictionary of Theology says demon identity cannot be known. Dick says they cannot be known, but they are neither the souls of the dead nor fallen angels. I'm sorry, there should have been a cross in these ones. Okay. They cannot be known. They are neither fallen angels nor the souls of the dead. Then Dr. Koch also says they are unknown, but they are neither the souls of the dead. They are not the souls of the dead. Then Derek Prince says they cannot be known, but they are not fallen angels. Then the rabbinic teaching says they are the souls who were unfortunate to have been clothed with bodies because God was tired and he rested on the Sabbath day. He didn't come back to put bodies on them, so they are roaming about as demons. This is Jewish teaching in sometimes. Then God says they are the souls of a pre-Adamic race. That means some people live before Adam, and after they died, they became demons. Now Schaeffer says they are falling angels. The Stanford say they are falling angels. Zubritsky says they are falling angels. Oregon says they are falling angels. Augustine says they are falling angels. Lombard says they are falling angels. Kraft says they are falling angels. Unger says they cannot be known, but probably they are falling angels. Navier says they are falling angels. The Book of Enoch says they are the Nephilim. That is, some angels came and married some women and had children with them. And when those children died, they became demons. Their spirits became demons. Then Chris Ward says they are the Nephilim. They are the children between fallen angels. And then Gaul says they are the pre-Adamic race of human beings. Josephus says they are the souls of the dead. Philo says they are the souls of the dead. Campbell says they are the souls of the dead. Lardner says they are the souls of the dead. Kim says they are the souls of the dead. The Greeks say they are the souls of the dead. The Chinese say they are the souls of the dead. The Hebrew says they are the souls of the dead. The Japanese says they are the souls of the dead. This is fallen angels who came to steal people's wives to go and have children with them. And this is another one who came to steal somebody's wife. In the Book of Enoch, one of the children of Noah traveled, and when he came back, his wife was pregnant, and he took him to his father. That is in the Book of Enoch. He took him to his father, and the father said, let's wait till the child is born, and we'll know who the father is. When the child was born, he was a hybrid between the fallen angel and the wife. And they asked the wife, say, an angel came to sleep with her. That is the Book of Enoch. This is an angel who is stealing somebody's wife. The Book of First Enoch makes, according to Stewart, McGee, and Andrzejewski, the basis of the Nephilim theory and even the falling angels theory is the explanation of Genesis chapter 6, verse 1 to 6, given by the non-canonical and apocryphal book of First Enoch. The book of 1 Enoch makes many ridiculous and outrageous revelations which are not found in the Bible. For instance, the book reveals the names of holy and fallen angels which are not mentioned in the canon of scriptures. It describes the Nephilim as growing to the height of 450 feet. They had psychic powers. They ate all the earth's vegetation. They drank human blood and ate human flesh. They are believed by this book to have built the pyramids, taught men architecture, the occult, and stole people's wives and fathered children with them. The inclination by the Lord Jesus Christ that angels do not marry in Mark chapter 12 verse 25. The absence of the suggesting in the Bible that marriage in Noah's days was a cross-species marriage between angels and women. The non-canonical source of the theory and the fact that fallen angels are never called sons of God should put to rest the Nephilim theory and even the fallen angels theory. The source of the Nephilim theory and the source of the fallen angels theory is the explanation given by the first book of Enoch, which was rejected by the Jews and rejected by the early church as non-canonical. Unfortunately, that remains the explanation of many Christians, that demons are fallen angels. Where they got it from, it's not from the Bible, it's from the first book of Enoch, which was rejected. Now, why demons are not fallen angels? The first reason is that demons are disembodied persons, but fallen angels have bodies. Demons are disembodied persons. A disembodied person or spirit is one who has been disinherited of his body. A disembodied person once lived in a body, but no longer does. Angels do not become disembodied because they don't die. Luke chapter 20 verse 36. And therefore, fallen angels cannot be demons. Angels have spiritual bodies in which they move and operate for or against human beings. An angelic body can be shape-shifted to look like natural human body. When some angels fell from their estate and became fallen angels, they did not lose their bodies. They only lost their holy nature and status and became evil. Fallen angels, therefore, still possess their spiritual bodies in which they live, move, and operate. The second one is that demons crave human bodies, but fallen angels do not. As disembodied persons, demons are unable to express themselves unless they possess an animate body. That is why demons even crave human bodies, especially the bodies of human beings. As many as a legion of demons, that is about 6,000, were in the demoniac of the gatherings. One cannot imagine that number of fallen angels in the body of one man. Angels do not need to possess bodies in order to help or harm their owners. The angel who rescued Peter from prison did not enter him in order to take him out of the prison. He struck Peter on the side and told him to dress up and possess him or his donkey to achieve his name, the Prince of Persia, and the Prince to hinder the answer to his prayer. They obstructed the Holy in a fight, and he does not enter any. 22 verse 3. Satan has a body. This man, by putting evil thoughts and suggestions into their mind and luring them to act them out. Out. But fallen angels are wrestled with, are cast out of their victims, suggesting their location within the victim's body. This is in heavenly places. Satan, the chief of the air, if heaven, Daniel lived. are cowardly. Character traits. These are character. One would not expect King Satan, the fallen angel, to a fully armed, strong man who guards his house and keeps his goods safe. His kingdom was also described as not divided against itself. Angels are beings of great strength. Psalm 103 verse 20. Only one angel sent by God almost destroyed the city of Jerusalem and her people. Had God not rescinded his decision, made him stop. 1 Chronicles 21 verse 15. Angels have not lost their angel as a result of their fall. Their strength is only misdirected against God's purposes. The sixth one, demons can have diseases, but fallen angels cannot. Our Lord Jesus Christ describes some demons as deaf and dumb. These are not angelic characteristics, since angels do not have fleshly bodies and therefore are not subject to diseases. This is evidence that demons are different from fallen angels. Though the two entities exist, they work for Satan at different levels in Satan's kingdom. The seventh one is that demons once entered pigs. Angels will not stoop that low. A legion of demons once found the bodies of some 2,000 pigs attractive enough to enter. Mark chapter 5 verse 1 to 13. This is not surprising because as body spirits, demons are restless outside an animate body and therefore crave bodies. The best body that serves as a home for them, however, is the human body. When they were being driven out of the man and did not want to go roaming restlessly in dry places, they preferred the next suitable abode, the bodies of the pigs. Angels are not disembodied spirits and therefore do not crave the bodies of other creatures. They do not need to enter a body to either help or harm its owner. And being higher on the ladder of God's creatures, it will be inconceivable for fallen angels to condescend so low as to enter pigs. The legion of demons who entered the pigs could therefore not be fallen angels. It is easier for human beings to step one step lower to enter pigs than for angels to step two steps lower to enter pigs. The next one is that demons are gender specific, age specific, country specific, and can't speak all languages. But fallen angels are genderless, they are ageless, have no country, and should be able to speak all languages. These details about demons' gender, age, and country are usually encountered in deliverance sessions when manifesting demons give responses to questions asked. I once expelled Fanti-speaking demons from an Ewe woman who did not speak Fanti. They told me that they were two deceased fishermen and two deceased fishmongers from Elmina. The spirit of a dead woman whose daughter had come to me for deliverance prayers once corrected her daughter, who had informed me prior to the prayer that assumed was their hometown. Her mother's spirit, which had possessed her, corrected her and told me that they were rather from a village near Asyom. As for demons who speak no English, I have come across many. Oh, we are sorry that there is some problem with the AC and the technicians are working on it. Please bear with us. I have come across many demons who don't speak English. Angels, however, are genderless, ageless, and have no earthly country, and should be able to speak all languages. Jesus once questioned some demons about their identity, and they disclosed that their name was Legion. A legion is a battalion of about 6,000 Roman soldiers. Isn't it possible that the spirits of a whole battalion of Roman soldiers who had died in a battle had found their way into the demoniac of the gatherings? Couldn't that be the reason why he lived in the cemetery and was so strong? And couldn't the one who spoke on behalf of all the others be the commander of the battalion? Now, why demons are human spirits? Human beings, the first one is that human beings are the only spirit beings who become disembodied. Human beings are the only spiritual beings who become disembodied and therefore could be demons. The other spiritual beings, that is the divine beings and angelic beings, do not become disembodied because they do not die. When Jesus, the divine being, wanted to taste death, he did not take an angelic form which does not die, but a human form which is subject to death. Human beings become disembodied when the spirit or soul separates from the body at death. The body is usually buried, but the soul and the spirit which make up the person who lived inside the body live on and travel together to either paradise if he believed in Christ, or to Hades if he did not believe in Christ. The disembodied human souls in Hades are the unclean spirits of the Bible. When Lazarus died, his soul went to Abraham's bosom, but the rich man's soul went to Hades. Jesus said the inhabitants of Hades will attack his church, but will not prevail against her. Fallen angels do not live in Hades, but in the heavenlies, and cannot be the spirits from Hades that Jesus says will attack his church. 2, demons call the human body their house. The demons Jesus spoke about in Matthew chapter 12, verse 43 to 45, who after leaving a victim goes to roam restlessly in dry places, refer to the victim's body as my house. He will say to himself, I will return to my house from which I left. Though this could be a reference to the place he previously occupied, it may as well be a reference to the place demons feel most comfortable and at home and at rest. Some demons once entered some pigs, but didn't survive in them for even one day. These demons, however, had lived in the demoniac for years. Demons outside of a human body are restless and find rest only when they return into a human body. The human body is home for them, just as water is home for fish. A fish out of water is as restless as a demon out of a human body. It is in a human body that demons are best able to express all their personality traits. Demons find the human body the best place to live, feel comfortable, at rest, and able to express themselves because they are persons who once lived in human bodies. They left their bodies and became disembodied because of death, which separated them from their bodies. Once back in a human body, they feel at home and at rest, and often resist being expelled from the human body. 3, demons as unclean spirits. The Lord Jesus usually referred to demons as unclean spirits. Clean and unclean are terms that are used in the but not for angels. Angels are referred to as either holy, Mark 8:34-38, or fallen, Matthew 25:41. Jesus told his disciples that they were clean because of his word which they had received, John 17:5. He also told them that not all of them were clean, John 13:10-11. The unclean one was Judas Iscariot. Human beings are also made clean by the washing of the water of the word, Ephesians 5. The blood of Jesus Christ also cleanses human beings from all sin. Angels are holy if they remain in their original estate, and fallen if they did not remain in their original estate, Jude 6. Angels cannot be called clean or unclean, because the blood of Jesus was not shed for them and does not cleanse them. If a human being is unclean in life because he has not received the gospel and has not been cleansed by the blood of Jesus Christ, his spirit out of the body at death is an unclean spirit. 4, demons as familiar spirits. It appears the version refers to as familiar spirits in the Old Testament are what The word for divine expository dictionary. The first, you say, the troubled spirit, the dead. Then you say, is who claims to summon forth the spirits of the dead. There is no doubt, therefore, that a familiar spirit is the spirit of a dead person, and so is a demon, since familiar spirits are the Old Testament equivalent of demons in the New Testament. 5. Sacrifices to demons. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, 19 to 20, the Apostle Paul in his letter to the Corinthians said, what am I saying then? That an idol is anything, or what is offered to idols is anything. Rather, that the things which the Gentiles sacrifice is sacrificed to demons and not to God. And I do not want you to have fellowship with demons. In this scripture, the Apostle Paul says that pagan sacrifices are offered not to God, but to demons. Cross-reference in Deuteronomy chapter 32, verse 17. According to him, the graven images called idols to which these sacrifices are dedicated are nothing. The psalmist says that they are not body parts of human beings. They are obviously not the ones who receive the sacrifices offered by pagans. In Psalm 106, evil and immoral practices corrupted Israel in the wilderness. The sacrifices of the spirits behind Jesus in nature and constitute the soul which body of a victim produces blind. Unbeliever who was the soul, spirit, still cleanness. Such a mind, spirit, soul possesses a person. It produces in the person's body the curse of blindness that it carries. That is why Jesus referred to the demon as deaf and dumb. It was not the demon-possessed person who was deaf and dumb, but the demon. And once the deaf and dumb demon was cast out, the victim spoke and could hear. 7. Pagan Jewish and first century Christian views on demons. Alexander Campbell has asserted that all the pagan authors of note whose works have survived the wreck of ages from Hesiod to Celsus affirm the opinion that demons are the spirits of ghosts of dead men. He has also indicated the views of Jewish historians of the first century, such as Josephus and Philo, in support of this opinion that demons are the spirits of the wicked dead. This must have been the popular understanding of demons by the people who lived in the days of Jesus Christ. This is because the gospel writers are not seen to have provided any special meaning of the term demon in their writings. The philological law of translation and of criticism, which underlies the truth of which all our dictionaries, grammars, and translations are formed, according to Campbell, states that every word not specifically explained or defined in a particular sense by any standard writer of any particular age and country is to be taken and applied in the current or commonly received signification of that country and age in which the writer lives. Having known the popular understanding of demons in Judea and in the early Christian era, and especially having known that neither Jesus Christ nor any of the gospel writers did give a hint as to a special, private, or peculiar interpretation of the term demon, it is safer to interpret the word demon in the similar manner in which a word which was generally understood at that age was used and was to be interpreted. Words such as Messiah, prophet, priest, Sabbath, covenant, circumcision, Lord's Supper, altar, and the like were used in the gospel in the way they were generally understood at the time by Jews and Greeks. But there is no hint that they had any private or peculiar interpretation. The term demon, which has no private or special interpretation in the Gospels, must also have been used in the same way it was generally understood and interpreted by the people of that age. According to Campbell's account of the time, the term demon was generally understood to mean the spirits of the wicked dead, and must have been the sense in which Jesus Christ and his apostles used it. Otherwise, there must have been a hint that it had a special or private interpretation and usage. 8. Jewish and Greco-Roman thought accommodation of the belief in the spirits of the dead operating through the living. When Herod the Tetrarch heard of the miracles of Jesus Christ, his immediate conclusion was that he was John the Baptist, whom he beheaded, who had risen from the dead. Mark chapter 6, verse 16. The Tetrarch was definitely not saying that John the Baptist had resurrected from the dead, since the head was with his wife. He also did not mean that John had reincarnated, since Jesus was a contemporary of John and did not appear suddenly. What Herod meant was that the spirit of John the Baptist, whom he beheaded, had possessed Jesus Christ and was at work through him. Herod was influenced by both Jewish and Greco-Roman culture. He therefore must have voiced out the popular belief among the Jews, Romans, and Greeks that the spirit of the dead person could possess a living person and act through him. On one occasion, Jesus asked his disciples to find out what the popular opinion of the Jews was about him. Matthew 6:16-4. He was told that the Jews thought that he was John the Baptist or Elijah or Jeremiah or some of the Old Testament prophets. The Jews did not mean that Jesus Christ was any of these prophets resurrected or reincarnated. They simply meant that it was the spirit of one of these prophets that had possessed him and was at work through him. The Jews and Romans and Greeks of Jesus' days accommodated the thought of the spirit of dead people possessing the living and operating. Dead are not under the control of the devil and therefore do not become familiar or unclean spirits. Spirits of the unrighteous dead, which are when the righteous die, souls or spirits go to paradise, they go to Hades, the world of the spirits dead, to also awake, carried by the angels to the bosom. 16. So, and being in torments in Hades, he lifted up his eyes. In Hades, the spirits of the unrighteous dead are before attaining the age of 120 years for him has no scriptural basis. Concerning the chapter 14, verse 22 to 20, until it further, since they will be denied and also suffer eternal death in hell. These restless and dissatisfied souls of the unbelieving dead in Hades are an important tool in the hands of the devil in his fight against God's purposes in the living and in the church of Christ. Jesus told Peter, "And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it." The gates of Hades is figurative of the power of Hades, which is no doubt in the hands of the inhabitants of Hades. Disembodied in Hades, the only means of attack from within. There are those who think souls of dead unbelievers are in hell and cannot therefore be demons on earth, or that the dead cannot be contacted by the living. They should not forget that even Satan and his fallen angels, for whom hell was prepared, are not in hell now, but operate in the world's space. Again, they should not forget that there was a real and ancient practice of consulting the dead. God warned Israel not to join the heathen in this practice. Leviticus 19:31, Deuteronomy 18:10. Isaiah cautioned the people of Israel in Isaiah 8 verse 19. When they say to you, consult the mediums and the spirits who whisper and mutter, should not a people consult their God? Should they consult the dead on behalf of the living? The famous case of King Saul consulting a medium at Endo, a woman who had a familiar spirit, to call up Prophet Samuel for advice concerning the battle with the Philistines, should disabuse the minds of anyone who thinks that the dead cannot contact the living or vice versa. Was it Samuel who came up? Not very likely. Nevertheless, the woman called an old man who was definitely by the spirits of dead people. These are cases from Ghana. Agency and reported on Ghana. 29-year-old man Eugene Asamoah was believed to have of Asamoah. This to the chief's palace for the people named to be summoned for questioning. To be sure that it was the spirit of the deceased who was speaking through the girl, his checkbook was given to her to sign, and she was able to sign his signature for the family to cash money from his account at the bank without any difficulty. The second case of a Ghanaian woman possessed by the spirit of this woman, the mother of this woman personally narrated this of two male relatives. The family members sent her away from the funeral grounds and poured water on her to bring her back to herself and to prevent her from disclosing further information. All these took place at the time the bodies of the deceased lay in state prior to their burials. This story is a clear case of the possession of the living by the spirits of the dead. This is what is variously reported in the Old Testament as a person with a familiar spirit, or in the New Testament as a person with an unclean spirit. The spirit is unclean because it was not washed by the blood of Jesus Christ, being the spirit of a dead unbeliever, and familiar because it is the spirit of a dead relative who is familiar with the affairs of the family. Third, a case of spirits of the dead in a woman in Germany. This case was reported in the biography of Reverend John Blumhardt and published in Germany in 1880. The event took place at Reverend's pastorate in Mottlingen in Württemberg, where he became known for his ability to relieve people of not only physical malady to have improved, including which doctor, spirits of heaven, one of whom was fourth China, missionary to China, not believe that his mother, his interpreter, Mr. Chu, had told him multiple stories of spirit possession cases which he personally witnessed. When missionary Nevius saw parallels of the Chinese cases with demon possession cases in the New Testament, he began to collect and document them. In one of the mission stations in Western Enchu, in the village of Chuang Tio, there lived two Christians, a man and his son, who suffered much opposition and persecution for their faith from the rude inhabitants of the village and even from the female members of their own family, especially Mrs. Song and her two daughters-in-law. On one visit, Dr. Nevius recalls that he was informed of the recent death of Mrs. Song, and he found the two daughters-in-law reading Christian books. The explanation for this, as he was informed, was that soon after Mrs. Song's death, one of the daughters-in-law passed into an unconscious state, manifesting symptoms very similar to those which characterize cases of demon possession. In one of the manifestations, a voice spoke through her, purporting to be that of the deceased Mrs. Song, declaring that she had gone to the land of the spirits and was refused entrance to the abode of the blessed, but has seen it from a distance. 5. The case of a 14-year-old girl possessed with the spirit of a dead girl in the U.S. This case was reported to Professor William James, a Harvard University professor of psychology, by Dr. Richard Hodgson, the secretary to the American branch of the Journal of the Society of Psychical Research. It involved a 14-year-old girl by name Lou Rancy, living with her parents at Watsika, Illinois, in the year 1887. Lou Rancy was diagnosed initially of suffering from various distressing hysterical disorders and various trances. Later, Lou Rancy claimed to have been animated by the spirit of Mary Rolf, a neighbor's daughter who had Mary Rolf insisted that she should be sent home to Rolf's house. After weeks of homesickness, instead of Mary, it was in almost all respects the mechanism of Mary living in the spirit of the deviously, relieving her life through pregnancy with appearances. Mysterious occult, or the triangle of death, or the hoodoo sea. The area is bounded by roughly Bermuda in the north to Miami and beyond Puerto Rico. There is a theory that millions of disturbed spirits are in the triangle. Who take possession of pilots and captains of ships and steer the planes and ships off their courses to their eventual disappearance. An exorcist believed that the spirits in the area are from 10 million Negroes who were dumped or thrown overboard during the slave trade period. Usually, they were thrown overboard for attempting to escape and reporting sickness or pregnancy, while others prefer to jump in defiance, wishing to die rather than go to die in slavery. Other times, it was purely for monetary reasons, when the slave traders got more money from insurance than the direct sale of the slaves. When they got to the Bermuda Triangle and heard that the slave prices had gone down, the white people would get off the ship and they would sink the ship with all the thousands of slaves and they would all die in that area. And then they would go and claim insurance on the mainland. A case in point was that of the U.S. These supposedly tormented souls have managed to turn Bermuda Triangle into the graveyard of over 140 ships and planes, and more than 1,000 people who over the years have disappeared without trace in the region. According to Dr. Kenneth McGall, a British surgeon and a psychiatrist, and a former missionary to China, the restless spirits of the dead slaves take possession of the pilots and captains to draw attention to their state. They usually take possession of the pilots and captains and distort their judgment and make them believe their planes or ships are on course, when in actual fact, they are off course. A case in point was that of some U.S. warplanes which got missing in the Bermuda region, which Dr. McGall narrates, and I quote, "On December 5, 1945, a flight of 5 Grandman United States Navy bombers took off from Fort Lauderdale, Florida, for a training flight in perfect weather. Shortly afterwards, the pilots radioed that they were on course, although they were flying in the opposite direction. 2 hours after takeoff, all contact with it had been lost. A Martin bomber was immediately sent to search for the missing planes. Within 20 minutes, radio contact with it had also been lost. No trace of any of the aircrafts was ever found. In all, 6 planes and 27 men simply vanished into thin air. The spirits of the slaves dumped in the sea must have gone into the abyss by now. Those who remain to Spirits of the slaves dumped in the sea must have gone into the abyss by now. Those who remain to continue the reign of terror by these spirits of the dead are the over 1,000 others from over 140 ships and planes in recent times who have been drowned in the sea at that spot. Now, the dilemma of Dr. Koch. Dr. Kurt Koch was a noted German theologian and a Lutheran pastor who did a lot of studies in occultism and ministry to those suffering from its effect. In one of the books on the subject, Demonology, Discerning and Overcoming Demonic Strongholds, he voices out his dilemma. On the one hand, he suggests that the spirits of the dead are not free to roam about, could not be the spirits which possess and speak through living persons. On the other hand, however, he had a difficulty of what to make of the voices which sometimes speak out of the possessed people purporting to be the spirits of their ancestors. In France, For instance, he was raised once with a possessed woman, out of whom came voices which claimed to be those of the spirits of her dead grandfather and grandmother. I had a difficulty explaining. Then the last one is the experience of is a senior pastor of West Lagos Baptist Church. Recounts his first encounter at the funeral of a departed woman of their church. This was not long after he had become a Christian and had discovered that when he prayed for the sick, they got healed by some divine power. This was in the 1950s, 7 years after the end of the Korean War, when the country was poor and did not have electricity in all parts. The wake of the departed believer was being held in her house, lighted by kerosene lamps in her, as her body lay in state. While there, the image of Jesus Christ telling Lazarus to come out of the tomb forcefully came to him, so he went to the corpse and commanded the woman to get up. To his surprise, the woman got up. To the amazement and shock of all the mourners, some of whom even collapsed. The young man present followed a Korean traditional belief, which indicates that if a dead person comes back to life and those present do not beat him back to death, they will all die. As they beat her, however, a male voice was heard from her saying, "I am going." When they asked who the voice belonged to, whoever was the speaker mentioned the name as Mr. Che, a farmer who had died 2 years earlier due to the mishandling of agrochemicals. As they continued to pray, the spirit of the deceased Mr. Che left the woman and she lived. This experience was Dr. Kim's first encounter with demons. It gave him the initial idea that demons could be the spirits of dead people. Over his many years of ministry, he had prayed for and cast out demons from a lot of demon-possessed people. During a 3-year survey in which he tabulated the response of the demons in 8,000 possessed people during the time of demon expulsion, the statistics was overwhelming in the support of the fact that demons are the spirits of dead unbelievers. When Dr. Kim did a survey over a 3-year period and asked demons in demon-possessed people who they were, this is the result. 7,998 out of 8,000 said they were the spirits of dead unbelievers. 2 said they were angels. 1 said he was the spirit of a believer who backslided. Then 1 said he was the spirit of a believer who committed suicide. Dr. Kidon Kim's statistics of 8,000 respondents over a 3-year period probably provides the key to answering the question as to the real identity of demons. In my practice of expelling demons from people for over 20 years, I have not once come across a demon that identified itself as a fallen angel. They have all mostly identified themselves as the spirits of the dead, and sometimes gods or spirits from the waters. What used to baffle me in the past was when they identified themselves as known living persons. Over the years, I have come to ascertain that these are witches or wizards who bewitch my clients with their witchcraft. Conclusion. Madam Chairperson and Co-Chairperson, ladies and gentlemen, there is sufficient evidence in the Bible to suggest that demons exist, ill influence mankind, and are overpowered by the authority of the name of Jesus Christ. The Bible does not, however, elaborate on their origin and identity. Nevertheless, seeking to ascertain their origin and identity is not a futile exercise. This is because knowing their origin and identity facilitates their easy expulsion from their victims. When their true identity is ascertained, their cover is blown off and they can easily be expelled from their victims. Richer nations with the most powerful and well-armed and well-trained armies in the world, even spend millions of dollars on espionage missions to secretly spy on other nations. They do this to find out the military capabilities and strategies of other nations in order to adequately prepare for a war with them when it occurs. It is in a similar sense that finding out the identity of demons is useful. Contrary to the popular belief among Christians that demons are fallen angels, biblical and experiential evidences show that they cannot be fallen angels, but are the spirits of souls of dead unbelievers. When we think demons are fallen angels, we are afraid to go near where they are, since fallen angels are very powerful and destructive beings. When we know, however, that they are the spirits of dead unbelievers who are cursed and condemned by God, all that powerful can have confidence in driving them easily out of their victims. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Kobinama Nodakwa, for that wonderful delivery. I know we have tons and tons of questions to ask, but we'll allow Doc to relax a little. We'll do some few things, and then we'll come to question and answer section. We want to appeal to our audience online. Please, on Facebook and on YouTube, you can live chat. So please start sending your question. Those of you who want it in the video format, send it and will be made on the screen. Once again, we apologize for the inconvenience in this place. Still working around it to get it solved. It's a time we want to take a special offering. Yes, we know it's a public lecture, but as part of the lecture every year, we take a special offering that helps the cause of fostering scholarship in the body of Christ in Ghana. We want you to look into your wallet, your purse, and maybe your briefcase, if the bundles are there. And give out bountifully an offering to help the work of the Lord. And we know that he who gives bountifully, Paul says, shall also reap bountifully. So we'll call on the Eldonami minstrels to give us a song. And the ushers will come round. And we urge you all in the name of the Lord. Please support this cause in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. and rise and then compromise the rest of this. Thank you very much, Elder Minstrels, and thank you for your offering. May the Lord look upon it and bless you according as you have given. In Jesus' mighty name. Finally, I think the demons have been exorcised from this place. And the air conditions are on now. And I think what happened this afternoon is a practical demonstration that demons do influence people. because the technicians on standby for no reason. One was in Medina, one was at Okponglo. So we believe they were influenced to go there. We have taken them to the basement, so our deliverance team is taking care of them. We want to acknowledge some few people here. Here we have Charles Richter Addo in the building. Can we see him, Richter Addo? Then we have Mr. Kwame Banga, B.N. Banga. Please, let's see you from, okay. We have Professor Daniel Sapong from Crossroads Community Church. Let's put our hands together. Then from La Côte d'Ivoire, we have Patricia Hamza. Shall we put our hands together? We also have Dr. Nia Lote from Crossroads Community Church. Then we have Dr. K.G. Treme from the USA. And Merlin Gisman, also from the USA. I saw Dr. Jechi from the School of Pharmacy, Legon. Okay. I saw Selassie also from School of Pharmacy, Central University. And then my boss is in the house, Mr. Francis Kofi from Department of Pharmacy, Kolebo Teaching Hospital. God bless you for coming. We also have the former Registrar of Berea Academy in the person Minister God Saves Ahumble. Shall we see you? God bless you. And then from Togo, Lome, we have Pastor Akagbo. God bless you all for coming. I want to hand over to the chairperson. Before I do that, I can see very Reverend, am I correct, or Emeritus, Helena, okay, Poco Sakodie. Let's put our heart together. He's the head of Religious Broadcast, Ghana Television, GTV, and I want to say GTV is here covering this event. So, Reverend Mrs. Helena, sorry, Reverend, Very Reverend, see, I get confused with very Reverend Helena Focus Accordia. You are welcome. Please, shall we have a word of prayer? Father, we thank you for the offering we have in our hands. We thank you for making it possible for us to give to your cause. We ask that you bless every giver in the name of Jesus. We ask that their hands will make profit and they will lack no good thing. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
Thank you very much, Mr. MC. I believe we are all blessed by this wonderful, insightful lecture that has been delivered. The MC called it educative, liberating, and riveting. Indeed, that is what it has been. I'm glad the MC didn't assign the problem of the PA going off and air conditioning going off to demons entering the PA system. Those are the kinds of things we all used to do in the days of ignorance. Now we know that demons enter our disembodied persons, and they enter bodies, not PA systems, and not air conditioning systems. So don't go lay your hands on them and casting them out. They do not exist there. But we are educated about the proper attitudes that we should be having now towards not only the subject, but many of the subjects that many of us as Christians have only wavered on the surface of without bothering to inquire further and to go deeper into, to have the right understanding so that we can be full as Christians operating in the authority that Jesus has given to us. Ours, from what has been shared, is not to deny the existence of demons. If Jesus believed in them, why should we deny their existence? And ours is not to be frightened. And surely we should not also be overly preoccupied with demons, as some of us are preoccupied with demons. We have been dedicated. There is so much more that I know that Dr. Amano could have shared. Demons in others. What every believer needs to know about demons. Demons possession and demon expulsion. The thing about Dr. Amano and his lectures is that he will not leave you incomplete. He will make sure that you leave the lecture fully armed, fully equipped to confront the challenges that are out there in this world, and that Jesus expects you and I, as his children, in whom he has invested himself, to go out there with his authority to do his bidding. And therefore, Dr. Amano has written this book, which we are going to launch this morning. And not just launch, but leave with a copy each. It is so full, so rich, and so complete that after going through this, you will be a completely different, fully equipped field marshal in the army of the Lord Jesus. There is no doubt about that. Because as I go through the topics that he has diligently examined, dealt in, exposed, and taught, you will agree with me that you will indeed be fully equipped. These are things that we ought to know as believers and to practice as believers. And these are things that, remember the 70 who disciples who were sent out, and they came back after accomplishing much in preaching and casting out demons, rejoicing because of what they have saw. Indeed, it is in the experience of it that the fullness comes, and the experience through comes through acquiring knowledge and stepping out there to put that knowledge into practice. Hence, this great book that is at your disposal. And when they came back, Jesus rejoiced with them and thanked God that these things had been hidden from the wise and the prudent. We saw in the lecture how wise men and prudent men propounded all kinds of theories about demons and how to deal with them. And yet Jesus has revealed these things today to babes like you and I, to simple-minded like you and I, so that we can confound some of the wisdom, some of the traditions of these things that have been thought, and yet we fail to see the practical manifestation in our day-to-day ministry. Dr. Amano has brought education. He has brought answers. He has brought relief. He has brought understanding. He has not presented them with authority that you must take, but he has presented them in a way and manner that you will read, you will think through, you will decide for yourself, which is it? What is the answer? How do we indeed deal with this matter of demons as believers? And so be like a babe this morning by acquiring one of these books for yourself. Be like a babe this morning by starting it with the attitude of one who wants to learn and seek to find the truth. Be like a babe. By having caught the revelations in this book, be ready to share it with every Tom, Dick, and Harry who comes your way, because it's like a pearl that you have discovered, and you want to share it, and you want others to be blessed by it. This book deals with 13 chapters, amongst which are, do demons exist? I believe there's no doubt about their existence. It deals with the kingdom of the devil. Takes us through some understanding of the kingdom of the devil and what role demons play in that kingdom. And then he elaborates on the identity crisis, which we have heard this morning. Who or what are demons? The fuller answer you will find when you read the book. And then he talks about the different theories. He went so fast, we didn't catch all the theories. But when you read the book, you understand the different theories that have been propounded about demons, so well explained and argued. And then he concludes with the more plausible theory, which is that demons are most probably spirits of dead ambulance in a way that will leave you convinced. And you will argue it yourself and come to that conclusion when you read the book. And then he talks about, so where do the dead go? He answers that question. Abraham's bosom, Hades, the abyss. These are things that we hear but haven't delved in sufficiently or researched into sufficiently. This book answers those questions. And then the characteristics of demons. This morning we discovered that demons can actually compel people to write our checks. And so if you brought your checkbook here, better write the proper check before some demon impersonates and writes your check for you. But there are characteristics that we should know about. How demons enter their victims, we need to know about it. And then more importantly, how do we expel demons from people? Our mandate is to cast them out at every opportunity. And yet without the knowledge and the equipping, we do not cast them out. And they continue to rain havoc upon ourselves, upon our families, upon our ministries, upon our businesses. Ours, the Lord is waiting for us to do the expelling. And then after demons have expelled, the question is, what next? You don't leave people empty, hopeless, without hope. But you leave them in a state in which they can continue reigning in the victory that they have experienced over demons. So you can see that this is a complete book. This is a thorough book. And it doesn't even end it there. It goes on to provide a chapter of questions and answers. So I believe that if some of us had already read this book, the questions that we want to ask, we don't even need to ask them because the answers are already provided in this book. I think you want to give the Lord a hand clap for such a wonderful gift to the body that is being presented us this morning. Dr. Mano, if I know him, if he had his way, he would give every one of us a copy of this book free. This is the nature of the man. But we believe that this ministry should go to the uttermost parts of the earth. That this work, this researching into things that are murky in the body of Christ, that need deeper understanding, that need clarity, should continue. And therefore, not only are we launching this book, but I want to ensure that this work and this enterprise will be sustained. And so we will be given the opportunity to buy the books for ourselves. But before we do that, I want to do an appeal. It is an appeal for sustainability. It's an appeal that so that research work like this will be made will ensure that there will be many more copies of these books available for every believer in Jesus desiring to operate in this ministry. Fully equipped and fully for this work. I would like three of the baskets to be brought here. These are copies of the book with other goodies in the bags, which I will not mention. If you are curious, buy one and you know what is inside. I'm going to ask for three people here to support this work with the amount of 3,000 Ghana cedis only. 3,000 Ghana cedis. If you value what we have received, if you value what we have heard, we believe that this must go on and it must reach places, it must reach nations, because the gospel must hit the utmost part of the earth. And this is an area that is plaguing millions of Christians. For lack of knowledge, there's much perishing in the body today. And so, we're seeking three sponsors. 3,000 Ghana cedis. You want to sponsor not because you have 3,000 cedis in your pocket. I'm looking for people who want to sponsor. They don't have it, but by faith and conviction of what has been shared this morning, they want to be part of this enterprise. They want to invest in this enterprise. And so they want to raise up their hands. Come for one of these and offer 3,000 cedis in sponsorship. Are we here? Are we men and women of faith? Our churches, faith-based built churches. Can I see a hand then? Do I see a hand? Ghanaians always want somebody to take the lead. I take the lead. Two more. Have the demons taken our faith out of us all of a sudden, so that there are none amongst them who by faith, not because they have, but they believe that within a month, God will make all grace abound and they will redeem this pledge. Do I see a hand? Do I see a hand? Do I see? God bless you. A second. Okay. I believe there's one more person to take the third for 3,000. It may not be an individual. An organization, a church you belong to. I would like the ministry I represent to invest in this work also. So I would like the Full Gospel Business Men's Fellowship to receive one also. Two thousand cedis. Surely the demons cannot still be in this place. 2,000 cities. God bless you. One. Cities. 1 month, no problem. 3,000 cities. God bless you. Two thousand Ghana cities. We've had four for 3,000 cities. Surely the demons must be trembling by now. 2,000 cities. Do I see a hand? 2,000 cities. One thousand Ghana cities. There's a hand. 2,000 cities. Wonderful. Over here. There's a hand here. Over there. Right. And another one. You see, I like this fundraising. We go forward and then we go backwards and then forwards. Another one for 2,000 Ghana cities. 1,000 Ghana cities, okay. Any others for 1,000 Ghana cities? 1,000 Ghana cities. 1,000 Ghana cities. Three more golden baskets have to go. Three more. 1,000 Ghana cities. One is gone. Two more. Ah, another is gone. Praise God. One more. Praise the Lord. One more. It's gone. Yeah, it's gone. One. Wonderful. This is what I call a manifestation. That indeed the demons in the room have been defeated. And we are sponsoring this work to the utmost part of the earth. What is the next category? Okay, 500 Ghana cities. 500 Ghana cities. 500 Ghana cities. As for this, I believe every church, every ministry, there's one here. 500 Ghana cities. Any others? Very quickly, 500 Ghana cities. Every ministry, every church represented here. 500 Ghana cities. 500 Ghana cities. Do I see a hand there? 500 Ghana cities. Yeah, there's one there. There's another at the back. Another back to my left. There's another at the back, the very far back. 500 Ghana cities. Any more? 500 Ghana cities. 500 Ghana cities. Let's do this very quickly. Very, very quickly. I mean, demons have to flee. They have to flee. They can't hover around any longer. 500 Ghana cities. Any more? There's a hand there. 500 Ghana cities. Any to my right? 500 Ghana cities. Let's support this work. Let's support this cause. 500 Ghana cities. Any up there in the upper room? 500 Ghana cities. Okay, 300 Ghana cities then. 300 Ghana cities. 300. Very quickly, 300. 300 Ghana cities. Do I see a hand? There's a hand here. God bless you. 300 Ghana cities. Another hand here. 300 Ghana cities. Another hand to my right. Ushers, very quickly, 300 Ghana cities, that's one here. Any others? One to the back here, one to the right here. 300 Ghana cities, another one to the back there. Kwesi, another one back there, that's one here. 300 Ghana cities. Very quickly, 300 Ghana cities. 300 Ghana cities. 300 Ghana cities, Kwesi right in front of you. Ushers, I think we need more ushers. Let the baskets flow. 300 Ghana cities. Kofi Kwesi right in front of you. Right. 300 Ghana cities. Any more? 300 Ghana cities. 300 Ghana cities. 200 Ghana cities then. 200 Ghana cities. 200 Ghana cities. Somebody raised their hand for 300, so we go back. 300 Ghana cities, or has the hand gone down all of a sudden? 300 Ghana cities, there's a hand up there. Any at the top, 300 Ghana cities. Right, 200 Ghana cities. 200 Ghana cities. 200 Ghana cities. There's a hand at the back. 200 Ghana cities. 200 Ghana cities. There's a hand at the back. Any others? 200 Ghana cities. 200 Ghana cities. 200 Ghana cities. Let me say that you may not have the money on you here, but you can pledge and redeem that pledge within the shortest possible time. So don't be intimidated by the non-availability. You can pledge and redeem that pledge. 200 Ghana cities, we are still at. Okay, we go to 100 Ghana cities now. 100 Ghana cities. 100 Ghana cities. 100 Ghana cities. 100 Ghana cities. Hundred Ghana cities. There's a hand at the back there. Ushers, the hands are going up faster than you are moving. There are three hands up there. Three hands up to the right. 100 Ghana cities, very quickly. 100 Ghana cities. Any other hands up? 100 Ghana cities, very quickly. And now last of all, 50 Ghana cities. Are we okay? 50 Ghana cities. Below 50s, the demons, they don't tremble anymore. So 50 Ghana cities, that is the trembling line. Let us all be part of the trembling line. 50 Ghana cities. 50 Ghana cities. I'm told 50, you should pay now. Now. 50. Shishishi. 50 Ghana cities. 50 Ghana cities. There's a hand up there. 50 Ghana cities. There's a hand there. There's a hand up there. 50 Ghana cities. Please keep your hands up high so that you can be easily identified. There's one up there. 50 Ghana cities. There's a hand there, Usher. Two hands here. Very quickly, 50 Ghana cities. We want every basket to go. 50 Ghana cities. There's a hand up there. Everybody got a copy. 50 Ghana cedis. We're wrapping up now. 50 Ghana cedis. The hands up. Cedis, wonderful. You have the opportunity to buy a copy nicely packaged in the atmosphere of an air-conditioned room. So, brothers and sisters, let me thank you for your support. One thing that you can be assured of is that every seed sown in this enterprise will reap a bountiful harvest to you and your ministry. That this message, this instruction to go execute a mandate given by our Lord Jesus Christ to be busy casting out demons as a matter of course, it will be carried out because of your support. God richly bless you. Thank you. Thank you very much, our brother, big brother, George Pra. I think he's really proving that he's the president of the Full Gospel Businessmen Fellowship. Some of the things, you have to be a businessman before you can do it well. God bless you, and God bless you for also picking a copy to support this great work we're doing here. We are at the point of questions, answers, and reactions. As I said earlier, we have online audience as well, and some of them have sent in their questions already. But since they couldn't buy the book online, I'll be giving we'll be taking 5 and we'll do agree. Okay. So, we want to take our first set of questions to be a set of 5 questions. And please, everybody is entitled to 1 question. If there is a need for a follow-up, we will see. But when you come, please, you are entitled to 1 question. And go straight to the point, be brief, and the questions will be appropriately addressed. So, shall we see by hand the first set of 5? Okay, I have 3 on the far left, and I have 2 here. Okay, so 3 are pointed this way. Please, because of our live audience, you need to face the camera. So please, proceed this way. And the 2 here. Please, let me see the hand again. The 2 here, please proceed this way. Thank you very much. You tell us your name and where you're coming from and your question.
Hello.
While they come forward,
we acknowledge the presence of Evangelist Dr. Albert Abuaji Fasin from the Foundation for End Time Repentance, one of our new sponsors. Doc, we say you are welcome.
Good morning. My name is Nanefua Eswamensa. Doc, you said when the believers die, they go to wait for the last day in paradise, in Hades. We've had people who have said they've had visitations into heaven and hell. I want to know if that is a full vision of what is to come, or it's what is actually happening. Because people have seen heaven, people have seen hell. But you are saying that God is still preparing those two locations for the sinners and the believers. So I want to know how, what is it that they see that makes them think they've seen heaven and hell? Thank you.
Thank you, Doug. My question is about traditional religion. We believe from onset that in our time of old, when we're not yet Christian, whatever happened, we go to inquire. And the man is able to tell you, and sometimes it is true. Now, in reference to the book of Luke chapter, forgot the text, where Abraham 16 and the poor man and this thing. I want to know, is it the soul of the sinner, is it confined or released? Thank you.
My name is Lawrence Amevo from the Fountain House Chapel. My question is, oftentimes you watch deliverance services, you see the demon in the person says, I am the queen of the sea. I am an idol. I am a serpent spirit. In making all manner of animals, sometimes they are crocodiles, lions. They are disembodied spirit of dead people. I want to understand.
I'm Sandra Tamaklo, and I'm so happy that today Doctor has touched on this topic. Actually, when I was walking up here, I didn't know that somebody was following me who has been asking us questions about this body, spirit, and soul when we were growing up. And that's my father. No, he was following me. So this morning, I'm so happy to touched on that, on this very aspect. And what I wanted to ask today is that I remember my father once told us that we keep it. Thank you.
For handing over my question is, we saw that there is a soul and spirit and body. Now, in Genesis, when God created Adam, it was a clay on the ground. We read, and when God breathed his breath into his nostril, he became a living soul. Am I lying? Adam became a living soul. You and I, we are living souls. Now, we have places for the dead souls. We have dead souls. Do we have? Yeah. Now, the spirit comes from who? God. And God is spirit. Can the dead man has power over his spirit that was given to him by God? Then, if not, that spirit in us is like somebody who is a tenant in somebody's house. His building, he is occupying. So if he fails to pay his rent, you sack him, isn't it? Right now, do we know how the spirit came into us and we have become a living soul? And when I die, I can still use my spirit to enter somebody as a demon spirit who died not in Christ. So that's between these three things: body, soul, and spirit. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much too. But we want to insist that you keep the question very brief, Father. So I was unable to cut him, but for you, I will cut you. So please, when you come, ask your
him to go to heaven or go to hell. Who says in John chapter verse 15 that nobody has ever been to heaven? Saw a as for a vision, it's not real. It's about something that it can be something that has passed already, or something that is yet to happen. If they say they saw a vision, I don't have any problem with them. But if they say they went to heaven, then they are lying. In the same way, if somebody says he went to hell and not that he saw a vision of hell, he is a liar. Because hell was prepared for the devil and his angels. It was not prepared for human beings. So if the devil himself, for whom hell was prepared, is walking about in town, how can Bob Marley or the Pope or Michael Jackson bypass the devil and go to hell? The Bible says when people die as unbelievers, they go to Hades, which is the world of the spirits of dead unbelievers. And then the righteous go to paradise. In these states, they don't have bodies. It's only the spirit and the soul which left the body. They are all waiting. The righteous are waiting for Jesus to resurrect them and take them into eternity. You can call that heaven. I call that the next world. But the unrighteous go to Asamado or Hades. Over there, the devil still controls them because he was controlling them when they were alive. And so when they die, he still controls their spirits in Hades. So in Hades, he sends them to come and attack and destroy the works of God. Okay. Now, consultation of the dead. Is the soul confined? Yeah, many people have a difficulty believing that what people go to consult are the actual spirits of the dead. They say they are impersonating spirits. They are spirits, familiar spirits, which come to impersonate the living and claim to be those. Where are those familiar spirits from? God made only three spirits: divine beings, angelic beings, and human beings. So familiar spirits are the spirits of the actual people who are talking. So when people go to consult and they call the dead, they have called the dead person if he's an unbeliever. If he's a believer, you can't call him because he's in paradise. The ones they call are those who have not believed in Christ and they died without Christ. They can call them and consult them, and whatever they tell you, most of the time they are true. But that is called necromancy. It's an abomination to God. Christians should not go to consult the dead. If you go to consult the dead, what happens is that you come back possessed by that spirit you have gone to consult. Then those who claim to be reptiles and crocodiles and serpentine spirits and mamiwata spirit. Mamiwata is not a spirit. Mamiwata is a fish. Mamiwata is a mammal which looks like that. They have talked about meme. Nobody has ever seen one in the whole world. They are myths. One time, some biologist saw one at the estuary between the white volta and the sea there. It's a mammal. Mamiwata is not a spirit. Besides, animals don't have spirits. So a snake cannot have a spirit. There's no spirit of a snake. I think what happens is that, you know, families have totem symbols. So some families, Adriana people are dog with fire in their mouth. I don't know why all our cultures, primal cultures, our totem symbols are animals. So the person is coming from Adriana, he says he's a dog. Or from some other family. Besides, animals don't have spirit, so an animal spirit cannot possess anybody. I think the behavior is what they use to describe themselves. That is why some can be a crocodile, but the crocodiles don't have spirit, so a crocodile spirit cannot possess anybody. They are, and then some of them are gods. We know that Paul says gods are nothing. There are spirits, actual spirits behind the gods. In the Old Testament, they knew that the sacrifices they gave to the gods were given to spirits behind the objects. And those spirits are the spirits of the dead. So all demons are spirits of dead unbelievers. Some of them can decide to live in the mountains. Some of them can be in the cemetery. Some of them can be in the sea. And when they are in the sea, they call themselves water spirits. But they are all spirits of the dead, which have chosen to locate in different places. Then the 120 years lifespan. I don't know how you learned, where you learned that one from. Your father told you. Okay, that is true. God gave, you know, he started, human beings used to live tonight and connect with him. Live without it and you'll be okay. Gods don't have spirits, they have souls. They eat, they walk, they reproduce. So the spirit can live. A soul is a person. Then the spirit, so that the body is just a container, two of them live. So when somebody dies, the person lives. The person is still there, only that we can't see him anymore. If he died as a Christian, he goes to paradise to await the resurrection, where God will give him a new body, and then he will enter the next world. But if he dies as an unbeliever, he's in Hades and is restless. And if he died below 120, he wants to continue to live. How? To enter somebody. And if he was a drunkard, he does not lose the desire to drink. He only loses the body. But now he cannot drink because he doesn't have a mouth. So what he will do is that look for somebody whose doors are open. He enters and he will use the person's mouth to drink. You know, sometimes when somebody does something and he goes to court and they ask him, why did you do this? I don't know. I didn't do it. It's true. Most of the time it's true. He didn't do it. But he did it. Somebody in him used his hands to do it. Amen.
As promised, we'll take two questions online, and then we'll pick the next set of questions. This question is a short one. Can a demon kill a Christian? Can a demon kill his pastors as demonic attack, leading to prolonged painful periods of deliverance? That only makes, how many mental cases failed? Had pastors recognized, can you perhaps
provide guidelines for makers and demon those questions from our own. Okay, so those ones were sent and printed. There are some we have on the template that will be done soon. So let's take two in addition to this, then door comes up. So the next one is, we ready for you, those in the control room. Okay. Roger Ahiambe, and I think I know this man, he's a pharmacist at Kolebu Teaching Hospital. Asking, please, in Luke 11:14-22, Jesus was accused of casting out devils by Beelzebub, the prince of demons. In Jesus' response, he did not refute that view. Instead, his response shows these demons have allegiance to Satan. Can you elaborate? Can the spirit of an unbeliever make the living have cancer or other disease condition? The woman was bound by Satan for some years in Luke 13:16. Okay. Doc, please, did you get the question? But we'll keep the ones on the screen. So probably you can address the earlier three, and then you come to this one. Thank you very much.
Can a demon kill a Christian? Yes. If a Christian allows a demon to enter him by what he does, the demon can kill him. Only that he will not go to hell because he's a Christian. But he will die. Then psychotic cases. This is very interesting. And we pastors should be careful. It's not every case that is demonic. Some of the cases are really pure psychiatric and psychological cases. We should ask to make a distinction between what is demonic and what is psychiatric. Sometimes people come to me and they themselves are convinced that they have demons. And you cannot convince them otherwise. And if you tell them that, no, madam, your case is a psychiatric case, they won't believe. From you, they will go to another person. Recently, a little boy who is about 8 years, about 5 years, the parents have gone everywhere and for this boy to be able to speak. And the boy has received all kinds of marks. When they brought him to me and I examined, this is an autistic child. It is autism. And all the signs are showing. If you ask the boy, he doesn't want to look into your face. He can't sit at one place. He's all over the place. And I told them that this is an autistic child. He doesn't have a demon. So please, I called an autistic center, not knowing that they even live very close to the center. So I told them, please, this evening, go take your child there. And then they will examine and assess the child. And they will confirm to you that this is an autistic child. Autism is a disease that affects children. You cannot see it until they are 18 months old or sometimes 36 months old. So when they are children, you cannot tell. When they reach that stage, then it begins to show. This is not a demonic case. You roam. They say the man said he has sold 3 of his cars to look for this guy. They go to this place. I knew of another cerebral palsy child. And this boy could not walk. And that has been everywhere. Has been to TB Joshua, has been to Pastor Chris in South Africa. Unless he doesn't hear of any prophet who is, he will carry the boy there. You had this boy had a child. Right. That is the only thing that one can say. Come out. Tell me the last one. In a mission house, and this Nigerian girl who was taking a prostitute in Europe, he kept the girls there from Nigeria, and then we were interested to know who she was, sent to Italy to become a priest. We tried to convince her to go back to Nigeria. She said no. They have taken her to shrines to go and swear that she will not escape. They have seized her passport, and so she was just ready to go. We tried to convince her not to go, but she said she will go. One evening she came to church, and that is when we knew there was something wrong. For the first time, she came forward to dance when we were singing. The strange thing was that when the music stopped, she was still in front dancing. Then we knew that there was something wrong. As usual, being pastors, she has a demon. And for 3 days, come out, come out, come out, come out. Come out, come out. And then we were confused. So sometimes we'll gather around her and say, tell us your name, who are you? Then she'll mention her name, I am Matilda. And that is her name. She's Matilda. Then we say, you are not Matilda. Tell us your full name. She said, I am Matilda Abifade. Then we say, you are not a demon. She said, if I'm a demon, cast me out. Then she started taunting us. Didn't you say that, Pastor? Pastor, you say I'm a demon. Cast me out. So we realized that though, one day I told my friends that Jimmy is here and Pastor Mike is here. I say, Pastor Mike, this thing is very demo. Let's take her to the hospital. Then they said, no, there was an argument. Then finally we decided to take her to the hospital. We bundled, he said she won't go. One day, Pastor is here. What do you have to know? She stripped naked. And she was in Kambu, Kambu. And stripped naked, and she had a potato on her head. Everybody, I'm going to evangelism. Then she was in the same context with the pastor from Togo who was with us. We had a speak. So come and see myself. Come and see myself. She's naked. So Jimmy went and gave her. Then she rushed into the room and got dressed. So when we took her to the hospital, at the Accra Psychiatric Hospital, the doctor looked at us and he was laughing. He said, you see, you pastors. She wouldn't even come out of the taxi. So we had to force her out of the taxi. So the doctor was watching us as we were trying to drag her. He said, look, you pastor, see, I'm going to give her just one jab, she will sleep. And then the doctor gave her a jab, boom, then she slept. He said, you see, you pastors. So we should be able to get wisdom to know which is demonic and which is psychiatric. Unfortunately, psychiatrists don't want to accept that. We want to accept that in case some cases are psychiatric. They don't want to accept that some cases are demonic. So you hear psychiatrists lambasting people who take people to prayer camp. Recently, Dr. Martin, who is a neuroscientist, organized a seminar at Legon, and they invited me to be there, so I was there. And come and see these neuroscientists and psychiatrists. They are ruling out the possibility that anybody has a demon. For them, everything is mental. So I asked them a question. I asked Dr. Ohene at the conference that, Dr. Ohene, haven't you had a case whose condition has improved with prayer? Then he said, anyway, I'm also a Christian. I believe in prayer. And I said, but you are here lambasting that there are no demons, or people who have cases are only psychiatric cases. But of course, we have to learn to refer psychiatric cases to the psychiatrist so they can deal with them. And then demonic cases, then we handle. That one we can handle. Amen. Then Beelzebub. When the people accused Jesus of casting out demons by the spirit of Beelzebub, no, he responded. He said, if I do that, by what do your sons also cast them out? If I cast out by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God has come. So Jesus didn't admit that he cast out demons by Beelzebub, but he admitted that Beelzebub is there. And there are people who cast out demons by Beelzebub. So not everybody who cast out demons is a true man of God. The fact that somebody can cast out a demon in itself does not prove that he is a man of God, because people can cast out by Beelzebub. I read a book, which is The Beautiful Side of Evil. That's the title of the book. It means that some evil, they also have a beautiful side. They can also cast out. Recently, I saw on TV 3 at Kaukudi, a Muslim who was casting out demons. So just the fact that somebody has cancer. Can a demon cause cancer? Yes. If somebody dies of cancer as an unbeliever, the curse of cancer is stamped on the soul. So he leaves the body, but the stamp is on the soul. So when this demon enters a living person who doesn't have cancer, cancer is going to begin to be reproduced in the person's body. Amen.
On the question, I think it keeps recurring on the question.
She changed her name to Inshira. At the time she came to see me, she called Inshira. But the apostolic pastor only cut the hair. This kingdom is not divided against itself to deceive us, to continue to come to them. If you go to this one, he will go and pay something to them, to this one, as if he is going to protect you. But they are all doing the same way.
Doc, for bringing clarity on that one. We're going to take a set of five again. The hands are up all over the place. So let me see from the right. One, two, three, four, and five at the back. No, at the back. At the back. So please come. I'm giving our first timers the preference. So please bear with me. But I'll call some old timers, no problem. So please come, tell us your name. Is very important.
The powerful delivery. In Mark chapter 1, verse 34, it reads, "And they healed many who were sick with various diseases, and cast out many demons. And they will not permit the demons to speak, because they knew him." I want to ask, why do we allow even demons to speak? Don't we know? Are we not aware that it can create a lot of confusion? So Jesus never permitted the demons, but in your delivery we found that in the demoniac Jesus knew that he has been possessed. Yeah, so please, I want to know, why would Jesus not allow demons to speak? Thank you.
I'm Timothy. I want to know from Doc, because listening to him we have the impression that all the main issues have to do with demons. Then my question is, what do fallen angels actually do? What are their activities? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Pastor Samson Okain. In Doc's delivery, he mentioned that Christians do open the door for demons to enter. I want him to give us examples of what Christians do that really open the door for demons to enter, practical ones, so that we may not know. You cannot be possessed, but if you open the door, then they will come. So doctor should help us all before we leave you.
My name is Nicholas Newman. I want to know, since Pastor said if an unbeliever died maybe under 120 years, the soul is allowed to move. And he says that the same demon can kill a Christian. So perhaps if a Christian is killed by a demon under 120 years, is that Christian soul also allowed to move about until the 120 years?
My name is Nobodika from Ho. What is reincarnation? And if an unbeliever who dies before 120 years, the spirit is able to come and live in the living, how different is that from reincarnation, if it isn't?
Yes, there are times Jesus didn't allow demons to speak because they wanted to testify that he was the Son of God, and he does not take testimony from demons. But there were times when he wanted to know facts about them, he allowed them to speak. For example, what is your name? And the demons answered, my name is Legion, because we are many. If he had not had that response, to from the beginning, it will appear as if he was dealing one demon, because only one, I. It was after he asked, what is your name? He said, my name is Legion, because we are. So sometimes you ask and they respond for you to more information about what you are dealing with. They brought a 16-year-old boy to me, and he had one in him. The first day we were able to cast out about 100, but because he was so tired, we had to postpone 25. Ask and you are informed. It's a progress report to give you an idea of the progress I'm making in dealing with. They are as many as demons, fallen angels. Look at the total number created. The Bible says there are thousands and thousands of ten thousands of ten thousands. So if a third, for example, assuming a third broke off and became fallen angels, we have plenty of fallen angels in the world. What do they do? How can 6,000 fallen angels come and enter one man because they want to kill him? What, don't you have something better to do for the devil? What do fallen angels do? They are in charge of countries. They are in charge of false religions. They are in charge of cults. They are in charge of all the big things the devil does. They don't enter. They control minds. There are over 2 billion of a certain religion who cannot accept Christ. Their minds are being controlled. They control governments. They control parliaments for them to make laws which are inimical to Christianity in countries. And that is what they do. They are higher up on the devil's ladder than demons. Demons are low. In fact, witches are even more powerful than demons. Demons are dead spirits. Witches are alive. Sometimes when you are casting out demons and a living person manifests, you think you are casting that tomorrow she is there. I pray for a certain pastor who came to me for prayer, and then the stepmother was the one who was responsible for all his problems. He said, you think we are going to allow you to become a pastor to come and disturb us in this family? He said, what? He said, yeah, the problem is that he makes him a fornicator. So he's a pastor, but he's fornicating around. He cannot control it. So I asked, where are you now? He said, I'm at Aboso Kainsele. How do Christians open the door? This is interesting. I prayed for a pastor who had demons. When the last demon was leaving, the demon was a woman, advised me to tell the pastor to stop watching pornography. That is the demon's advice. That is one way. If you live in sin, then you cry, mother, why are you going? Why are you leaving me alone? I will go with you. Okay, your mother has left the spirit. She's looking for a place to stay. You are saying she should come to you. If she comes, where is she going to stay? Inside the street. Then she enters you. A lady, I preach in a certain church. Then a lawyer who was there, she was so quiet during the evening question time, she didn't ask any question. Then in 2 weeks' time, I had a call from her, and she came to my office. Can I come to talk to you? And I said, yes. Then she came. I said, what's your problem? She said, you said two things that I have never heard before. Number one, you say a Christian can have a demon. I never thought so. And then you said the demons are the spirits of the dead. Then he said, how is that a problem? He said, my grandmother died in 2001. But I mourned for 3 days. I will not eat. And nobody could comfort me. Then after that, when I'm going, I can feel my grandmother with me. Sometimes I can even tend to see whether she is. Sometimes I talk to her unconsciously. Then she asked, could she be in me? Then I said, I cannot tell unless I have a test, which I administer to tell whether somebody has a demon or not. In our church, we call it deworming. Every Christian, from time to time, you have to go for deworming. You know, doctors advise that every 3 months, you have to go and deworm. Does any human being eat worms? No. In the process of living, you may, by mistake, have swallowed some demons through your water or through your food. So you may also have contacted demons. So from time to time, you come for deworming. And so, I've forgotten what I was saying. The lawyer. So I applied the test, and strangely, the grandmother was inside. Adiza. She said she was called Adiza. When did you die? I said 2001. Then she asked me, who are you? Then I said, she's my sister. Then she laughed. You don't know her from anywhere. She's my granddaughter. Leave her alone. Let us develop our relationship. Then later on, she said, I won't let her marry. That's all. I thought you said you loved her. He said, it is because I love her. That's why I don't want her to marry. Then I said, why? She said, if she marries, the affection for me will shift to the husband. And so she is never going to marry. Of course, eventually we drove Adisa out of the lawyer. And then she got free. So if your mother dies as a non-believer, don't mourn her. Cry a little. And let her go. Especially if you begin to see her in your dreams. And you're encouraging the dream. One day, if she died as a non-believer, you may find her inside your body. Okay, Christians, when Christians die, they go to paradise. And they have gone to a better place, so they don't want to roam about here restlessly. What do they want here? They have gone to a better place in paradise, so they don't come. Of course, they won't be allowed to come here. They are resting until the resurrection. It is the unbelieving spirits which are in Hades, roaming about restlessly. They are the ones who are angry that they didn't finish their lifespan. Besides, they want to continue to live. So, and besides, the devil sends them to come and harm you. People in the family. This is why they call it generational curse. It's not actually generational curse. But those who have died previously in the family, they keep on coming to stay inside those who are being born in the succeeding generations. And if there is a particular disease that runs through the family, they keep on transferring it to the generations. Then reincarnation. Reincarnation is not what we are talking about. Reincarnation is somebody who has lived for a certain number of years and has died and has come back as a cat. Or a goat. Or some snake. And in another life, he comes again as something. As a human being, as a woman. A man will come back as a woman. That is reincarnation. What we are talking about, everybody is an individual. Everybody lives and dies once. When you die, your spirit is hovering around if you are an unbeliever. And you can have a chance to enter. Our registrar told me he went to his hometown. And an old man was narrating an incident which he didn't understand. He had a son who was an armed robber. He was shot one time and he died. And he said this son, when he enters a room, as if he has some telepathic ability, he can tell where the money is and he will go and take it. Now this boy has been shot or he's dead. Now his son, who is 7 years, has started behaving like the father. Is it the reincarnation of the father? But when the man died, the boy was alive. So it couldn't have been reincarnation. So he explained to him that maybe the spirit of the father has come to possess the boy and is teaching him how to steal, to also become an armed robber. Amen.
Don't be like Adesanya.
So let's take three from them. And then late Prophet Kenneth Hagin of USA, while praying for a breast cancer patient who was given few days to live by her doctors, had his eyes opened and saw a demon appearing like a monkey chewing on her breast. After casting it out, it dropped and the woman got healed within a few days. Can the human spirit be responsible for that? Can a man of God, as a pastor, be possessed by a demon? The last online. Can it be that the devil, being a liar, has been trying to make it frustrate the ability of the Christian from knowing the structure of his kingdom? I suggest it takes the Holy Spirit to discern between familiar spirits and demons. I suggest what God concluded on is familiar spirit and not necessarily demons, but great work done. Call us, Doc, and Berea Academy. Okay, so Doc, we'll take your response to this online.
Okay, let me start from the bottom. Strangely, demons are mentioned only twice in the Old Testament. Always is familiar spirit. But familiar spirit is not mentioned even once in the New Testament. Which means familiar spirits in the Old Testament are the demons in the New Testament. They are the same spirit. And in familiar spirits, they are the spirits of dead people. And demons too are the spirits of dead people. Then the monkey-like demon. I'm happy that the man of God saw a vision of a spirit that looks like a monkey, but not a monkey. A monkey has no spirit. The monkey spirit cannot cause any cancer. It's the spirit of a dead person. Then can a man, that man of God, be possessed by that demon? No. If the man of God is living right, there is no way a demon can enter. But can a man of God be possessed by demons? Yes. A pastor, some tall pastor, taller than me, he came to me one day. He showed me videos that he is also a deliverance minister. But he feels sometimes that he also may have demons. But he cannot go and stand before the people he himself ministers to, that they should also pray for him. So he secretly came to me that I should pray for him. I thought it was a simple matter. So I even in my office, I decided to pray for him in my office. And when I started, for 1 hour, this tall pastor was bent down this way and was groaning for about an hour. Before I was done, he had flooded my office with saliva coming from their mouth. So yes, men of God are a good host for demons, because they will not seek deliverance. They will rather cast demons out of people, but they themselves will never present themselves for deliverance. So demons like them. They would like to stay in them quietly and hurt them, because they would go and seek deliverance.
Some cup packed. So this year, we decided to move to a bigger place where we can see ourselves and have a little bit of comfort so that we can partake in the program. But the challenge is that it costs a lot more money. As we're speaking, Kumasi is calling. Takoradi is calling. Swedro pastors are calling. We need to reach everywhere as much as possible. But it is money. So I have a small form here that I will respectfully and humbly request and ask of you, if you can just give me 100 cedis a month, 50 cedis a month, 20 cedis a month, 10 cedis a month, 5 cedis a month, so that we can put it together that over the period, it becomes something that we can use to at least launch a program. Sitting here for just a few hours costs so much. So we have our mobile account number, Berea Academy. And so if you can tell me, I'll give you 50 CDs a month. If I get 50 CDs a month and I have 100 people, I have 100 times 50 times 12, and it is something we can start a program with. So I will humbly and respectfully request that you will do us this favor. Amen. So I have in my hand these little pieces of papers. If you can put your name, your number, we can reach you. We can reach you on our, please, the ushers, please just move it around. They write it and you pick it back, okay? So that we can quickly just fill it for me. Yeah, please share. So whoever will feel it, you just drop it for me and I'll reach you by SMS or something. Just tell me, I'll pay 1 month. Contact me by, so that I don't even disturb anybody. Just write, 10 CDs, I'll pay a month, quarterly, 6 months, 1 year, I'll give you 100 CDs. And then we quickly... so that we can quickly mobilize to help ourselves. The unbelievers won't help us. Companies won't help us. We need to help ourselves. I hear you want to. Okay, I'll give you 1 second.
Hello. Thank you very much. And I just want to encourage you to support this ministry. I just want to encourage you to support this ministry. Pastor George is my father. I studied Berea Academy in Ghana. After here, I went to Korea. I'm the director of Berea Academy in Togo. Yes, the past years, I used to invite him whenever you have graduation in Togo. Because this time, it's difficult for me to invite him. But we need such a teaching. So please, it will be very good to support this ministry. Whatever you do it, God will bless you. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you. God bless you. Are we done? Any hands again? Up there. Are we okay? Dad, you have them back, collect them, and then we can. Please, let's have the papers back. Ushers, please. Let's have them back so we can. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you. God bless you. If you feel it, let me have it back so we can contact you by SMS or something. Thank you. Just indicate whether you want me to contact you else so that I don't become a bother. Thank you. At the top. Oh, let's get this over in a minute so we can. Thank you. God bless you. At the top. Okay, thank you. Please, this. The three people say, If plenty people are carrying, we bear the burden, it becomes lighter. The 10 CDs, we might not value it, but put together, we'll go a long way to stop the things going around us. Thank you. Oh, up there, are we done? God bless you. Amen.
All right, thank you very much, and all those who pledge support. Yes. Okay. Evangelist Fawcett wasn't in when we were doing the fundraiser, so I think he has, I think it's a check. Yes. So please, kindly come. He is the president and founder of Foundation for Airtime Repentance. Amen. God richly bless you. We told someone to buy the book, but they said they don't have the 50 Ghana on them. So I've asked Felicia to step down to 30 Ghana cities. So we want to just sell some copies now at 30 Ghana cities. Because when it goes to the bookshop, it will sell about 50 Ghana. Because the paid cost alone was 50 Ghana. So 30 Ghana cedis for a copy of the book. Let's shake our hands and the ushers will attend to you. So please, ushers, let's quickly. Okay. So we want to close, but we'll make the book available at the phone box at 30 Ghana for just today. In fact, for just the next 30 minutes. And then we'll change over. So please. It is time for you to invite the chairperson for her closing remarks. But before you come, Auntie Helena is in the house. So just say hello to us, and then the chairperson will give us the closing remarks. Thank you very much. So let's put our hands together. She is a minister of the Methodist Church of Ghana. I don't know if she's at Wadoya. I don't know whether she's still there.
I think I want to use this opportunity to say thanks. I don't know whose idea it was that when we go to church, we should only listen to sermons instead of have discussions. A lot of us are not growing as a result of that. And there are some churches I know, some of the leaders even set alarm clock there. They set you up for about 40 minutes, 20 minutes, maximum 30. And when you are flying, you hear the alarm going off to let you know that, cut it, it's okay, we don't need anymore. Just allow us to go home. Let us allow ourselves to be challenged. We come here once a year, we challenge ourselves, and then we go and we allow our pastors to just come and give us the 20-minute sermon every Sunday. How do we grow? We are African Christians and our challenges are different. Too many challenges. And not until, you know, we make time for our spiritual growth, we will be wasting a lot of time on the non-issues. And you know what I'm talking about. Too many non-issues are occupying our time in our various churches. And so we sit there, we go home, and all you remember was that the music was good, because you did a lot of good dancing. But if dancing alone could save, then the shatawales and the, how do you call them? Yeah, they should be flying, they should be more spiritual. It's not about that. And I've been thinking, I know, as I sat there, whose idea at all was it that pastors should only preach sermons and not engage congregations, you know, in intellectually stimulating discussions such as the one that we have just had? Can you go and tell your pastors on a point of order, say, calm down, let's talk. We have questions too. Don't we have questions? Thank you. God bless you.
That was wonderful. I'm going to be very brief with my closing remarks. In Luke chapter 13, some Pharisees came up to Jesus as he was going to Jerusalem to warn him that, you know, Herod was looking for him to kill him. And Jesus made that profound response: "Go tell that fox, I will keep on driving demons and healing people today and tomorrow, and on the third day I will reach my goal." It gives us the impression that if Jesus had 3 days for work, at least 2 of those 3 days, or 67% of his time and energy and effort, was spent on casting out demons. And so it beats my mind how today we have relegated this matter, this business, this discussion about demons to the periphery. Is it because we are not comfortable with the subject, or we don't know enough about it? Whatever it is, I believe today we are living here enlightened and educated. And as Jesus said, go tell that fox, go tell that demon, go tell those people out there that we will cast out demons today and tomorrow, and the third day we shall reach our goal. Amen.
I'm told our printer is in the house, the one who got the book printed, Yao Owusu. God bless you for a wonderful work done. So we've come to the close of this year's lecture. So soon, yes. But once we have your data captured, you'll be getting text messages from us. We organize a continuous theological education every other month, and we deal with topical issues. So you'll get an alert, and the venue is Hacho at Crossroads Community Church. As I said, this lecture has come to us by kind courtesy of Berea Academy, and the room is open. In August, we'll have an intake of new students. As I said earlier, it is once a week school. This year's admission will be a Monday school. So Monday from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. at Hacho. From August, school will be a session. So you can pick a form, enrollment form, for yourself, for a friend. Let's see you in August. Let's continue the discussion. But when you get our invite for a continuous education program, please turn up and God will richly bless you. We'll be proudly sponsored by Casper Limited, Nidal Craft, House of Food, and Herbal Technology. And also, Foundation for End Time Repentance came in with a support. We say God bless you. And I welcome here Minister Judith Opontaya to give us the vote of thanks.
Thank you, MC. I'm sure that all of us here are very aware that we have not wasted our time. We are going back from here more equipped than we came. And we want to thank God for this program. We appreciate Him for what He has done for all of us by using my own pastor, and you never know how proud I was sitting there listening to my pastor. And those of you who don't have the opportunity to listen to him week by week, I'm telling you, you are missing something good. I want to thank God for his life, for the time he has dedicated into the research, for this book which is going to go viral, because as Africans we have issues and some of them have been answered in the book. We thank God for Dr. Manu's life. We want to appreciate also the co-chairperson or chairman, that is our brother George Pra, who is also the national president of the Full Gospel Businessmen's Fellowship International. We thank God for our dear sister, the chairperson. I think she had to leave quickly to attend to other issues. Justice Selassie Sowa Williams. I can't cease to be amazed by her energy and the fact that she represents Christians who still stand for the truth in a society where judges are corrupt and justice is for sale. We still have a remnant. We thank God for her life and for the time she spent with us today. We want to thank all the clergy. It's not easy to bring all of them around. The very big ones, the very reverends, and the medium ones, and the small ones like us. We are all here today to support this program, and we want to thank God for your lives and ministries, that may the Lord bless you continuously. We thank God for the numerous sponsors, those who sponsored for the book to be printed, and those who sponsored today by buying the books. I'm sure that these seeds sown will have eternal rewards. When we get to heaven, you'll see some of the rewards of the seeds you have sown here. And even on earth here, you'll see the rewards in the form of liberating people who are bound by demons and didn't know they were bound. We thank you for being there to sponsor the books. We thank the chairperson or chairman of the Public Lecture Planning Committee and the committee itself. We are very appreciative of all that you've done to make all of us comfortable here. I must say that last year was very, very inconveniencing. I had to squeeze myself upstairs and make do with the television, because I couldn't see what was going on. You did a good job this year. We are all here very comfortably seated. May God bless you. We thank our special guests who have come from far and wide, and especially also our internet guests, those who are online from across the world. May the Lord bless you. Spread the word that demons can be cast out and that they are the spirits of dead people. We want to thank the music group El Dunamis. You are doing a good job. Keep it up, and thank you for being here. We thank our brother Eddie Mante also, who played the role of introducing the chairpersons. And of course, the Crossroads Community Church, the church that is behind Dr. Manu. We are the church that believes in the New Testament. We believe that things can be done. And the launch of this book is one of such beliefs. We don't put a price before God. You don't tell God, I need 20,000. Tell God what you need. I need 20,000 to go and buy a fridge. No. Thank God. Just tell God, I need a fridge. If it's 20,000, if it's 100,000, he'll give it to you. We needed this book published and launched. No matter its cost, we believed that it would be done. We didn't have the money at the beginning, but God raised the money himself. Money should not stop us. May the Lord bless all of you. We want to thank you, especially the audience. You were very interactive. The questions, I'm sure we still have some of them, and our pastor is available to answer them. You can send them to him. He will gladly attend to you. Thank you for being so participative. May God bless you. And I'm sure next year when we call you, you will gladly come, not only alone, but with a friend. God bless all of us. Amen.
Mrs. Judith Opontiria. Before the closing prayer, we'll ask the El Dunamis minstrels to give us the closing hymn. And I think we'll be sitting for long. Can we stand with them and sing the closing hymn? After which, I will call on Pastor Stephen Amubensa to give us the closing prayer. And when the closing prayer is said, the speaker and then the chairperson will process the refreshments at the back of the foyer. So please, we receive the refreshment. You wait and you'll be saved. God bless you.
Henceforth, with our assistants, with our house helps, with our gardeners, with our colleagues, with that kayayu that we ask for help, as we interact with every person, open our eyes to see what they really are. Never dying souls to save and make them fit for the sky. Father, help us, O God, stir our passion and compassion for them to make them ready for a blissful life after here and redeem them from the condemnation that is about to befall them as soon as they slip from this earth forever without a remedy. Open our eyes to see human beings what they really are. Never dying souls to save, and stir our passions well enough to do the appropriate things in time before it is too late. Even as we leave here, O God, thank you for your grace that has abounded towards us. Thank you for your word that has come to us. Thank you for the speaker. Thank you for everything that went on here today. Father, may you dismiss us by your grace, and may we leave here with passion to work for you, not to waste time. your grace abound towards us. May you, O God, as O God, keep us, spirit, souls, and body, safe in you. Cover us, O God, with your blood, and keep us, O God, from the contaminations of the spirits that have been released by the enemy. Teach us, O God, to know how to number our days and order our steps aright. May you restore and replenish every stone that have left your servants. And my Lord, anybody who has contributed to this, may you replenish and restore and bless gratify. And I may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit abide with us all now and forevermore. In Jesus' name, amen.
Have the book, we will sign some autograph for you, so please, we'll be at the back. God bless you once again for coming.